Assalamu alaikum. We'll start our second session for the day. So it is my pleasure to introduce our moderator for this session. Prof. Turki Al-Kharfi is a consultant neonatologist and professor of pediatric at King Khalid University Hospital in Riyadh. And Dr. Hatim Al-Amri is neonatology consultant and the CEO of King Abdullah Medical Complex Jeddah. Dr. Turki and Dr. Hatim, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Jubara. Our first speaker is Professor Hany Aly. He's a well-known figure in neonatology, and most of you would know him. He is the editor-in-chief for the Journal of Neonatal Medicine, the founder of Neonatal Neurology and Brain Development Fellowship, and he's also a pediatric advisory board member of the Food and Drug Administration in the U.S. He published extensively in the field of neonatal medicine, and Dr. Aly has many of the awards he received. He received the Patient Safety Award in Washington, D.C. He is currently the director of Division of Newborn Services and George Washington University, Professor of Pediatrics and Obstetrics. Dr. Aly will speak to us about neonatal quality improvement, keys for success. Please join me to welcome Professor Hany Aly.
Thank you, Dr. Turki, for your introduction, and assalamu alaikum, everybody. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The talk today is about neonatal quality improvement, keys for success. I have to tell you that I really was pleasantly surprised to get asked to speak about quality improvement. It sounds to me that scientific committee are really on top of the current topics. The area of quality improvement is now this a new language that neonatologists and other specialties are talking about it. And I'm actually completing my master's degree in quality improvement. So it was very interesting to get asked about it when I am and many are working on it. So the objectives that I would like to cover it is to go over what are the components of care in the NICU and how do errors occur and how to avoid them and how important is communication in improving care and what are the common processes and tactics for quality improvement. So, as I just mentioned, there are like new language that we are talking about when we are dealing with babies. That would be good that I will introduce some of it. Of course, the few minutes lectures is not going to cover it, but at least that would be the start for the introduction of this topic. So when you are in the NICU, you have the people and the materials, the equipment, the tools, methods, and communication. So these are components that we are all gathering these components together to provide care. So you may have the best physician or the best nurse, but not necessarily you have the best outcome because the other components are not synchronizing with it. So for people, you talk about leaders, administratives, and then the other people who are working in the team. So we talk about education and training and orientation and the appropriate staffing. Then the materials, medications, supplies, TPN, and so on. And then equipment, ventilators, monitors, pumps, and then the tools we are using to provide the care through the appropriate documentations, the forms, the checklists, and then the methods, policies, and procedures. And then communication, which is the practice to coordinate the management between all these together. I hope that things are not confusing. And of course, we can provide a lecture on each component, but I'm not going to do that. I will just cover a couple of slides on each component so that we just have the idea about it. So people, I will talk only about leadership. So is leadership a trait or a process? Are people born leaders or are we making leaders? So it's actually the combination of both. So there are people who are born with the trait to be leaders. However, leaders can be trained as well. And so the common phrase in the United States, dogs can be trained and leaders can be developed. So even if you have a high quality leadership trait in yourself, training will always improve things and even enforce things that you are doing. So you are doing in your position certain decisions, and you don't know that these are the correct things scientifically, or you are not doing some stuff that you probably should be doing it. And although leaders have an executive power, so people respect you mainly when you are in leadership position, not because of the position that you have as a leader. You are the director of the division or the dean of the School of Medicine or the chair of the department, but actually people are following you mainly because of your experience, your knowledge, and then your morals. They trust your morals and then the charisma. You are inspiring them to do some work. So there are multiple studies showing that different leaders change the same policies are there, but just having a different leader, people are full and are producing better outcomes with different personnel based on their charisma and their inspiration. So leaders manage changes while managers lead stability. So there are two different positions when we have the NICU. There is a leader in the NICU and there is a manager in the NICU. So you are not expecting from the leader to put the schedule for the on-call. This is really a very routine work. A manager can do that, can decide who's going to be on-call today and tomorrow and the weekend. But the leaders are more involved with changing the routine. So you as a leader in the NICU, you find what are or where are the errors and how can I change the routine to avoid these errors. And once you make this decision, the manager will be the one who will lead on to make sure that the policies are informed. So important traits, leaders should be responsible, proactive, inspiring, high integrity, determinant, self-confident, clear in communication. And communication really now, if you're going to choose one character for a leader, should be well communicative. Positive attitude, they never give up. Creative, culturally sensitive. So you have somebody from a national person, somebody from Saudi Arabia, somebody from Philippines, somebody India, American, and you are really sensitive to the culture for each people. Altruistics, Al-Ithar, they are really working for the people, not the people working for them. And adaptive, they can change with according to the different inputs from the environment. Team leader is a new concept. So nowadays there is a team leadership. So there is a CEO or the chairman, but there is always a team with him and they decide together. So really you have a combo of three people together. It is understood that this number one person, he is the person who's the decision maker, but he always in a continuous meeting with a couple of vice chairs or couple of vice presidents who are together doing the team leadership together. There is a rule called the 80-20 principle. 20% of your carpet at home gets 80% of the wear. And 20% of your clothes are worn 80% of the time. 20% of your employee take 80% of your time. Accordingly, quality improvement will focus on this 20% most important errors happen that will cause 80% of the bad outcomes. So, for example, 80% of serious medical errors involve miscommunication during handoff. So how much time do you spend during this handoff? The daytime shift are signing out to the nighttime shift. During that very short time, 80% of the serious medical error occurs related to that miscommunication at this time. It's really amazing when you learn this information. So what we do, there is some committee called Root Cause Analysis, or RCA. So the aim of the root cause analysis is to review, to determine what happened when a problem occurred. We are not trying to accuse who did it, but we are trying to know exactly the fact. What happened, why did it happen, and how to prevent it from happening again. And when we are doing it, we need to understand why people acted this way last night when the baby died. We don't want to know why they didn't do the correct way. No, we need to know at the time what was their thinking, because I want to block this mechanism from happening again. What will prevent future errors, punishing people or changing people or changing the system? So the answer is changing the system. So you can change people, but the same error will continue to happen. So there is the hindsight bias. What does it mean? After the fact, you really think, oh, that's so simple. Why they did it this stupid way? But because you already know after the fact. وَلَوْ كُنْتُ أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبَ لَاسْتَكْثَرْتُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ. That's the exact same philosophy. After the fact, I wish I bought this stock before it come up. Or I wish I sold my share before it go down. So you cannot just after the baby died, you say, oh, that is the hindsight bias. So why you think that was wrong, that happened? Oh, it's a common sense. Common sense, they should have intubated this baby. But that is really, this is nonsense, or what we call it, illusion. Do you have a policy to indicate or to enforce that in this occasion, things should have happened? If there is no policy, you say common sense, that means you are missing the policy. Then that is where you need to change the system to prevent the error from happening again. Accidents usually have multiple causes. Therefore, whenever something called miss, near miss, like an accident didn't happen, but we don't want to wait for the accident to happen. So usually when a problem happens, there is multiple problems in the middle has to occur for finally the system is completely broken. That's why the baby died. So you don't want to wait for a baby to die. Once you have one problem, then you need to act on it. And I'll show you some explanation. Human error is part of human being. To err is human. This is the Institute of Medicine indicated this phrase. So we really need to depend more on system rather than depending on the vigilance of the people, such as using resilient technologies, avoid reliance on memory and vigilance of people, try to use the more checklist you use, the better, and try to do simplified and standardized policies. The Swiss cheese model. So each slice, as you see for a Swiss cheese, has multiple holes. Each slice is a human being. We all have errors. But we put one slice next to the other, then the second slice will close the gap for the first one, and the third will close the gap for both. And really, to have a one hole that goes through the whole thing, that is very unusual. Once you have a hole through the whole thing, that's when the error will happen. Then you need to go back and try to close these slices again. So human system is similar to multiple slices of Swiss chiefs. A successful system should put multiple barriers, multiple slices to prevent errors. The holes in each slice is the individual errors. The holes through the system, that's a system error. Error reaches the patient when all holes align together. Here is an example. And this is actual example happened in our NICU. An infant has SVT overnight, supraventricular tachycardia. The fellow in the NICU called the cardiology service, who advised to administer 15 microgram per kg of digoxin. The neonatology fellow, he heard it 50 microgram, and the baby received 50 microgram per kg. Infant had severe bradycardia, cardiac arrest. He was just saved before death. So the answer here, should we blame the fellow? So the answer is no. Here are all the holes. No verbal order should be allowed. We didn't have a policy for that. In case of emergency that a verbal order will be taken, two providers need to confirm the dose over the phone. So after the cardiologist told the fellow, then the fellow should give the phone to a nurse or somebody else to hear the dose one more time. Then no order is written without checking with a reference book, the Harriet Lane or Neofax or whatever. Then computer should have a system to prevent you from writing the order wrongly. So the computer will have the safe range for each medicine. Then pharmacy, before dispensing medication, should check it with a book to make sure that the dose is going with the reference that they have. And then two nurses, before administering the dose, should review the dose together with a reference book. And that is really what's happening now. Multiple layer and multiple slices. So if one decided to make an error, then the other layers will prevent the error from happening. So really we divide the error into three components. There are human error, very similar to what happened in this digoxin case, or I tried to calculate the dose of Lasix before I gave it and calculated wrong. And in this situation, the action should be to console, to reassure the person, don't worry, it is a system problem, it was not your problem. No blame should happen here, because it's a pure human error, and to err is human. There is at-risk behavior, such as somebody is doing behavior, and his intention is very good, but it is risky behavior. A baby who is completely desaturated on 100% oxygen, and you don't want to intubate, or you don't want to put him on ECMO, and this is very risky. So we should not reward people who are doing risky behavior. So next day in the morning, when you in round, you say, oh, you did a great job. You saved this baby from being intubated last night. That's not really the answer. We should not encourage that. We should see, did he go with the policy or he didn't go with the policy? And this type of errors, when it happens, people who should coach them, train them, don't take risks anymore. Then the third one is the reckless behavior. That's somebody who's going against the policy intentionally, and that should be punished. But every time we have an error, we need to identify, is it human error or at-risk behavior or reckless behavior? And based on that, we need to act. So system engineering, what does it mean? No matter how well equipment is designed, and no matter how sensible regulations are, no matter how much humans can excel in their performance, they can never be better than a system that bounds them. Do you know who said this statement? That was the captain in the aviation system. Quick question. The chance for a passenger to die in a plane crash in the United States is 1 in 1,000, 1 in 10,000, 100,000, 1 in 1 million, or 1 in 1 billion. Any answer? It's a 1 in 2 billion. The chance for somebody to die in a plane crash is 1 in 2 billion. The chance for a patient to die in the hospital due to a medical error is 1 in 1,000, 1 in 10,000, 1 in 100,000, 1 in 1 million, 1 in 1 billion. 1 in 200. So why is this huge difference? It's not because pilots are smarter than physicians or flight attendants more beautiful than nurses. It has nothing to do with personnel. It has to do with the system. So death in the United States, the third most common cause of death in the United States is medical error, after heart disease, cancers, and medical errors. Total annual deaths in the United States, 2.6 million, and deaths related to medical error are 0.25 million. One-tenth of people die because of medical error. So how error happen? Mostly you have a communication problems. So it's so important to start the language of correct communications. So for example, there is what we call it the SPAR communication. SPAR is a form of structured communication between providers, and we need to train our ears and train our people to talk about SPAR communication. So SBAR, situation, background, assessment, recommendation. So somebody calling you at night from the hospital, I want in 1 minute to explain what's the problem. So he will say the situation, the background, the assessment, and recommendation. So he will call, I am Hany, calling you regarding baby Romero in the NICU. That's the situation. The background, this is the baby, was infant of diabetic mom who was admitted 8 hours ago with VSD. Then the assessment, the baby is running low sugar, less than 50, respiratory rate now is the 70s, he's reacting. Recommendation, I would like to do chest x-ray and start antibiotics. So really, you hear, you get the phone call in 30 seconds or 1 minute, you are trained to put the information to the person or to receive it the same way, and we call this the SPAR. So sometimes you hear stuff, and because of poor communication, you don't know who is this baby, what was the diagnosis, and how was he, and what do you want to ask about. So just have it this way prepared when somebody is calling us. There is assertive statement. It is used between providers during daily activity. So I'm working in the hostel or in the NICU, and I see a problem, and I would like to tell somebody it's a problem. So I would like to say it in an assertive statement. Should have four components. You call him by name, then they use the word concerned, then they state the problem and propose a solution. So for example, Ahmed, I'm concerned, your gloves are not sterile, we need to change gloves between patients. So just the word concerned, once I hear my name and hear concerned, then I know that it means assertive statement. Then I would listen more vigilant than somebody talking a regular language. There is a debriefing, we use the fast, focus in performance, not people, all team members included, solicit specifics and timely. So every time after any procedure, so after resuscitation in the NICU or in the delivery room, after putting central line, after attending delivery, then all involved people will collect together in just 1 or 2 minutes what did go well and what was bad. And then each one will just say one word or one sentence. Then this way we are improving. We do, on the other hand, the timeout before any procedures. So now when you go and attend the cesarean section, so each one will say his name, the neonatologist, the anesthesiologist, the obstetrician, each one will say his name, will mention what is the name of the patient and what is the name of the procedure, and then anyone has any comment before we start. If I'm putting a central line, the same thing. Me and the nurse and the fellow will stand next to the baby, just for time out, means that 30 seconds. Here is Dr. Ali and Dr. Such and Nurse Such. Baby, what's the baby's name? We are doing central line for what purpose? Any comment before we start? Then the fellow say, oh, we didn't give something for pain. Or the nurse will say, oh, that is the wrong baby or something. That we call it timeout. Before any procedure, you do timeout, and after each procedure, you do debriefing fast. Transition of care, we just mentioned about the time of sign out between coming shift and leaving shifts. 80% of serious medical errors occur during that time. So now we're doing what we call it huddles. So in addition to the NICU sign out between the leaving and coming, now we have the team of involved parties, anesthesia, OBGYN, and neonatology. We meet 10 minutes in the morning and in the evening. And they just go very fast on a list to saying, oh, today we will be delivering a triplet, we'll have this. And then the NICU will say, oh, we don't have beds, or we don't have staffing. Something just we collect together. Resilient technology, what does it mean? So resilient technology, it's really you program the machine to become resistant to the error. For example, we have the most common drips, dopamine or epinephrine. So now you can program the pump for the drip rate for each drip. So now instead of you put the solution and dial 0.5 cc an hour, you don't do that anymore. You fill the machine, oh, this is epinephrine drip, and the baby's weight is such, and I would like to run it at 0.3. The pump will alarm will not allow you to run at 0.3. The maximum for this weight is 0.1. That is the resilient technology. And the same thing for medication. How many times a baby received breast milk IV? It does happen. There are multiple medical reports in case report. So now if a medicine is dispensed from pharmacy to be given PO, it is put in a syringe that cannot fit on IV. It can fit only on the OG tube, on the oral gastric tube. And vice versa. Something need to be oral gastric tube, you cannot put it into the IV. X-rays, we cannot take the X-ray anymore before you put the order on the computer so that the X-ray is done with the label already printed. So the idea of doing the X-ray and then finding a label to stick it in, it does not occur anymore. And that's what we call it, resilient technology. Use of checklists, so important to simplify things. You are a smart person and you can, in your brain, calculate 10 different things or look to two different things or 10 different things. But for example, if you have a baby on CPAP, so I expect the nurse will go over these 20 items. Look to the nose, look to the bronchs, the tubing, and simplify things. So number one, it allows accountability. So it means that she really will check it every single piece. And number two, she may forget something that the checklist will allow her to do. So 5 more minutes, that's my time. So now how to do an improvement. So there are multiple ways of doing improvement. I just will visit what we call it the dashboards. So usually when we are looking for an outcome to improve, I would like to decrease infections. So now we need to sit down. What exactly you'd like to decrease? Then you start to focus more about specific measures inside the infection you would like to correct it. And then you make a dashboard of it. So for example, mortality because of sepsis. So in order to decrease mortality related to sepsis, we should really get the antibiotics to be given within 1 hour of diagnosis. We should follow blood culture daily or CBC daily. So you change the overall outcome into metrics of measurements, and then you make the dashboards under measures. And then you need to have data in your unit. Time right now, we do blood culture after birth. What time blood culture is drawn compared to birth time? So 67% of the time the culture was done in the first hour. So no, we need to change that to 100%. Then antibiotics were infused in 50% of the time within 2 hours. No, we need to make it 100%. So now you change the overall outcome into measures, and you make a dashboard, and then you make a responsible person for each, and then you put a due date for each, and that's what we call a dashboard for sepsis, for example. Then there is the PDCA cycle, so plan, do, study, act. You sit down, you put a plan, then you implement, then you collect data, you study this data that you collected, analyze it, and then you make an action. And that can go into cycles. So we are in continuous PDSA cycles because you never reach to the 100% perfection. So you do PDSA cycle, you find your sepsis rate improved from 50 to 70 because of now you're giving prophylactic antibiotic early. Then you do another PDSA cycle, now you are doing central line management improved. Then you improve more and more, and these are the PDSA cycle. The SWOT analysis involves when you are trying to make a plan on decision on something. So for each option you decide to do or a project, so should I use nasal cannula or should I use CPAP? Should I purchase this machine or that machine? Let's do SWOT analysis. What is the strength? What is the weakness? What is the opportunities? What I can gain out of that? What are the threats? And then you put all the data you have into these four categories, then you'll be able to compare between different options, different projects, different equipments, or even different units. So that it involves data collection. So now really having strong data is so important. It's not for research. Now we talk about quality improvement. And having a quality improvement officer in the division or in the NICU is now a mandate. When I say having it, so really we dedicate 50% of the full-time person, 150% time for a quality improvement officer who is going to be doing this work on a daily basis. So in conclusion, quality improvement is essential for practice safe medicine and improve outcomes. Quality improvement involves people, process, equipment, and system engineering. Communication is essential for a better patient care. Handoff represents a major vulnerability. Quality improvement relies on high quality data in the NICU. Thank you.